Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shift, Transform Motion into Progress in Business by Richard Lees and Azlan Raj, narrated by Jonathan Johns. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability/disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations of warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. It is sold on the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services, and neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. If professional advice or other expert assistance is required, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Foreword. At Dentsu, we are striving to be champions for meaningful progress. This is one of the core principles that underscores our vision. But what does it truly mean? For us, meaningful refers to activities that add value to people's lives, while progress is the positive manifestation of motion with the focus placed firmly on our desired outcomes. Meaningful progress is a force for growth and good. It is a force that can unlock unique possibilities to drive sustainable value and lead to lasting change. It is the gateway to the future for brands in all industries. I first met Rich and Az after joining Dentsu in 2020, and when they shared the concept of this book, I could immediately see how our ambition of championing meaningful progress was woven throughout his chapters. More than this, it maps out the connections that businesses of all sizes must consider if they too are to achieve meaningful progress. In the highly competitive and fast-changing world that we find ourselves in, keeping up is hard enough, and staying ahead can be a constant challenge. The currency of business nowadays is speed. Doing something is simply not good enough. There are numerous fronts that must be navigated simultaneously, and prioritizing the important over the nice to have can be hard to do. This struggle is one that Rich and Az understand well. The ideas they share in this book are simple to draw out. They are easy to explain and certainly important to connect. However, they are difficult to do, which is why so many businesses get stuck in a trap of constant motion, whereby a lot of tasks are done that keep everyone very busy and deplete budgets. But you lose sight of meaningful progress. When this happens, it becomes increasingly difficult to translate this movement into clear and measurable business or customer value. This is when the focus often shifts to processes and projects, moving away from customer needs and the value that is derived from meeting them. Az and Rich use a simple Formula One analogy to link the three core themes that a business must connect to create one seamless ecosystem for success. Drawing on their collective 50 years in the realm of customer experience, they use clear examples of the challenges that businesses face in order to highlight not only the importance of each core theme, but more importantly, the need to weave them across every element of the business landscape to deliver true value. The first of these core themes is a clear vision that sets the direction and common purpose for your organization, and the need for clear measures to ensure you remain on track. The second is the team, and the need for alignment of purpose across an entire organization. They also delve into radical collaboration, another of our passions at Dentsu, as well as the need for autonomy. The final theme relates to reading the market and understanding the external factors that affect every business's ability to compete effectively. The threads that connect these themes and their many integrated topics are the simple concepts of starting with the end in mind, recognizing that motion does not necessarily equate to progress, and actively seeking out and measuring that progress. If you can't turn motion into progress, what you are left with is a lot of very expensive movement. If you proxy motion for progress, as many businesses do, you will become stuck. As you listen, you may realize that your business falls into this category. If that's the case, you'll find tools in these chapters to help you turn motion into meaningful progress. I urge you to use them. Since starting my role with Dentsu, I have spoken to hundreds of clients, and all of them mention the same challenges. Chief among them are transformation and finding a way to measure the efficiency of their activities. In my career, I have been both client and agency side. I have worked with some of the world's biggest brands, and I've witnessed how these challenges manifest themselves in different organizational environments. I also understand the crucial role that strong leadership plays in navigating these challenges. I believe a leader's role is to provide a careful balance between hope and reality. Great leaders paint a vivid picture of what they want to do and where they want to go. They align people and resources around their vision of the future, but they do so without neglecting the reality of where they are now. They are transparent, honest, and realistic about what the journey from their current reality to their visionary future entails. This is the foundation for achieving meaningful progress, and it is these ideas that you will find woven throughout this book in an interesting and thought-provoking way. The compelling anecdotes and connected themes that are covered in this book are as applicable for marketing leaders as for CEOs. Dive in. Learn what you can from the years of experience Rich and Az bring to this space, and have the courage to invent the future that you're taking your company into. In doing so, you too will become champions for meaningful progress. Wendy Clark, CEO, Dentsu International and former president, Sparkling Brands and Strategic Marketing, Coca-Cola, North America. Introduction. Rocking horses don't belong in boardrooms. Don't confuse motion for progress. A rocking horse moves all day but goes nowhere. Alfred Montaubert. Picture a child sitting on a rocking horse. She is laughing as she sways back and forth. Maybe she is pushing the rocking horse to go faster, encouraging it by shouting phrases like, "Giddy up!" As you watch the child enjoying her ride on the rocking horse, you smile. She is safe, she is happy, and you know that regardless of what her imagination is telling her, she is going nowhere, in the physical sense. You leave her to her game, confident that you won't look out of the window to see her galloping across the garden on her rocking horse in half an hour. You would certainly think it odd if you walked into a boardroom to see the CEO, CMO, CTO, or any of the other directors sitting on a rocking horse. However, all too often, businesses have boardrooms filled with metaphorical rocking horses. They just don't realize it. They don't always distinguish between motion and progress, or know how to turn the motion they are generating into progress. Charting progress in a modern business world. The business world today, especially after black swan events like the 2008 financial crisis or the global COVID-19 pandemic, is characterized by an increasingly big number of known unknowns. It seems clear that the past is probably no longer a safe basis for predicting the future, and much of what we have learned and been taught may well have limited relevance to our future decision-making. The competition feels like it can come from anywhere, and time is definitely no longer on your side. As Rupert Murdoch said in 1999, "The world is changing very fast. Big will not be small anymore. It will be the fast beating the slow." To not only survive, but to thrive in the new world is a constant challenge that requires businesses to fast become the masters of many things. Agility, speed, and adaptability, ability to change, have become strategic differentiators, giving those businesses that can rapidly adapt and build a muscle to respond to change a massive advantage. Some businesses have the advantage of already being in this state. Let's call them the leaders. Others are undergoing massive transformations to close the gap and either attain or regain this state. Let's call them the followers who are playing catch-up. However, to do this requires sustained and directed momentum or motion, but motion alone will not give you the advantage. The advantage comes from turning motion into progress. This might sound simple enough, but often this is more difficult to achieve than it first appears. The result in many businesses is a great deal of motion that adds little real value and instead wastes precious time and resources, and may even contribute to a loss of competitive advantage. The opportunity, as we explain in this book, is to turn that motion into progress. To do that, you need to connect the three core themes of the business ecosystem, which we are calling the principle, the crew, and the season. The speed and availability of data, technology, analytics, content, and platforms is creating this perfect storm where we can finally capitalize on the opportunity presented by the total customer experience in a way that we just couldn't before. If brands are not on that journey to complete and total customer experience across those dimensions of sales, service, commerce, and marketing, they just won't be around in the future. Craig Dempster, Global CEO, Merkle. The race to the top. Our favorite analogy to describe what a business needs to do in order to turn motion into progress is Formula One. Behind the fast cars, daring driving, and excitement of race days, there are three key components at work: the principal, the crew, and the season. The principal of each team sets the direction and leads from the front. The crew needs to collaborate and work together to consistently improve the car, its engine performance, drive the car, and find ways to shave even 0.1 of a second off the lap time or length of a pit stop, because that 0.1 second can mean the team's driver wins the race. Then there is the Formula One season, which lasts for much longer than a single race. Every race throughout the season is different. The car itself will perform differently depending on both the track and the weather conditions on the day, and the crew will need to adapt according to the conditions. When we apply those three principles to a business, we can see a clear correlation to core enterprise functions and challenges. The principle represents the leaders within the business, the people who make those big decisions, keep one eye on the big picture, and make sure that the company is moving in the right direction. The crew is the broader teams, the people on the ground who make things happen. When they are all aligned behind an organization's vision, great things happen and progress begins to accelerate. The season is the external environment that will have an impact on not only how the business performs, but also on how the team functions and performs in different situations. The season is the one element of the pyramid that the business doesn't have total control over. What any organization can control, however, is how it responds to its environment. This becomes a game of agility, where the businesses that learn fast and adapt quickly survive, and those that don't, die. You need to have all three components of the pyramid in place and working together in order to achieve progress. Without all of these components, your business will struggle to successfully turn motion into progress. If you just have the principal with the season, but the crew is not aligned and engaged, you create fatigue. You will only have a short amount of time to build momentum and achieve your goals before you run out of energy. If you have the principal setting a clear direction of travel and the crew aligned behind them, but no awareness of the season and external environment, this leads to obsolescence. You won't be creating and delivering the products or services the market and your customers need. Finally, if the crew is responding to the season and working within the external environment, but is doing so without any leadership or direction from the principal, what you are left with is chaos. There won't be any coherence in your activities, and progress will stall. What many organizations are aiming for is what we discussed at the beginning. The principal setting a clear direction and communicating the big picture vision, the crew aligning with this vision, buying into it, and being given autonomy to work toward that goal, and the organization as a whole being aware of and having the ability to adapt to an ever-changing environment. The ideal state is to find a balance among all three themes. The economy has fundamentally changed. We've moved from a world with digital to a digital-first world, and there's no going back. Digital has become the way for people to connect, work, learn, and be entertained, and the imperative for digital customer engagement has never been greater. Every business must understand their customers to deliver personalized digital experiences. The brands that win this race will have hands-on leaders who are open to change, a culture built around trust, rapid decision-making and action, as well as a dedication to innovation and learning. most of the evolution we have seen through COVID-19 has centered on transactional needs, be it the global pivot to online shopping or the rise of digital finance. However, brands must also consider how these unprecedented times affect people at the cultural and emotional level. Paul Robson, president of Adobe International, Adobe. There are no silver bullets. If you have picked up this book, hoping to find a silver bullet that will solve your business's problems, we're afraid we are going to disappoint you. Harmonizing these three themes takes time, effort, and a great deal of motion. What we are sharing in these chapters, however, is aimed at helping you uncover how to translate your motion into progress and become a more adaptive organization in the process. Each part of this book covers topics related to that component of the business ecosystem. We begin in part one with leadership, which comes from the principle. Without a clear direction of travel, you may meander aimlessly or go in circles, so setting that North Star is an important starting point. You also need to know how to measure your progress. Without clear measurement of the right metrics, you can't see how far, or not, you've gone, and are therefore in danger of slipping back into a cycle of motion. In part two, we move to your team, an organizational ecosystem, including its culture. This component involves not only aligning your crew behind your vision, but also how you can support your team members to contribute to that progress, deliver on your goals, and do so in a way that draws on their strengths. Autonomy is one of the key concepts here, but this has to come with clear guidelines and a definitive North Star. Finally, we explore the enterprise environment in part three, which is represented by the season. These are the events that you have to manage and adapt to as a business, but they are the ones that are outside of your control. For example, the economy, political upheaval, global pandemics, and even the weather impact organizations of all sizes and in all sectors. This is not only about navigating challenges, but also about spotting opportunities and knowing when and how to take the shot that can significantly accelerate your progress. Uncovering your starting point. You and your organization are on your own personal journeys with your own starting point. At the end of several of the chapters, we have provided a link to a series of online exercises that will help you to understand what stage you are at, what direction you may need to move in, what changes you may need to implement, and where you can find support. Use these resources to help you apply the lessons from this book in your own business. Our aim is to help you understand how you can turn motion into progress and to clear any rocking horses out of your boardroom. Working towards meaningful transformation. We live in a world where competition really can come from anywhere, and businesses have to be able to rapidly respond to threats and adapt to change. Organizations must evolve multiple strategies and use these abilities to build and maintain persistent relationships with their customers. So, business transformation tends to be at the top of most large corporate agendas to modernize businesses that have fallen behind in some way and need to rapidly play catch-up. In many cases, there is also a customer experience transformation, CXT, happening to meet the fast-shifting needs of customers who today are empowered and in control. CXT is the combination of data transformation and digital transformation, which relates to a business's ability to respond in today's expectation economy. This is a world where customers are increasingly digitally savvy. They have choice. They are informed. They can and do vote with their feet, increasingly with their smartphones. They expect service. They want quality. They are vocal when they don't get it. If you are one of the many businesses that is transforming across multiple areas to make up lost ground, then this idea of building a business that can turn motion into meaningful progress will be very topical for you. In our current work for Merkle and Dentsu's Customer Experience Management service line, Rich as Chief Strategy Officer, EMEA, and Az as Chief Marketing Officer, EMEA, this is a topic we've tackled time and again with our clients. Over many years, we have seen and been a part of extraordinary transformational efforts, as well as attempts to transform businesses that did not gain sufficient traction. What we are sharing in this book is a set of themes that any organization can follow on its journey to becoming an adaptive organization. Turning motion into progress is a key part of that journey. After all, how else are you going to get off the starting grid? However, as we're sure you know, making progress requires far more than simply turning on the engine and putting your foot to the floor. The principles we share in each chapter are based on our experiences, where we pull together examples and analogies to illustrate what we have found to be most important to a business's ability to become an adaptive organization, and will hopefully provide you with the guidance you need to harness that adaptive behavior and turn it into meaningful progress. It is highly likely you already embrace at least some of them. However, if you are listening to this book, there are also likely some obstacles in your path, some of which you may not even be aware of. Our hope is that you will find some ideas that can help you navigate those obstacles and continue your journey toward adaptiveness in the most efficient way possible. If we help you overcome even one obstacle on your journey, we have achieved our goal. If you're ready, let's join the principal. It's race day.
Part 1. Principal. Day is breaking over Silverstone Racetrack on this July morning. It's the day of the British Grand Prix. The sun is shining, and there are no clouds in sight, just as forecast. There is already a shimmer of a heat wave over the parts of the track that are being warmed by the sun's rays. As the principal arrives at the track, they smile. They can go with their plan A now that the conditions look fair. Ahead of the race, the principal gathers their crew around them and gives them a final brief for the race. They explain the strategy, share any further information that they have gleaned from the reams of data generated during qualifying, and make sure everyone in their crew knows exactly what to do and when. The principal talks with the lead race engineer and the driver separately. They are clear, concise, and focused. The goal is that checkered flag coming down on their driver. Everything they have done so far this weekend and in the months leading up to this race has been with this goal in mind. Throughout the season, their strategy has evolved, taking each race as it comes, but there is always clarity over what the team is aiming for. As the driver returns, suited up and ready to climb into their car, the principal takes a moment to soak up the scene. Everyone is in their place. Everything is ready. The engine roars into life. The vibrations ripple through the air, and the smell of engine oil and fuel hangs heavy around the pit lane. The drivers start their slow procession to take up their positions on the grid, and the principal watches their car as it snakes along the track, warming up the tires. A final glance around and a quick nod to the lead engineer shows the principal all they need to know. They're ready. Every Formula One race team has a principal. This is the person who is responsible for communicating the team's vision and goals to the rest of the crew and leading for their constructor over the course of the race weekend. And indeed, over the course of the entire Formula One season, principals set the direction for their respective team and clearly articulate the team's purpose, not only for each race, but across the season and indeed future seasons. They make sure that changes are made to the car to give the team the best chance of succeeding on race day. They oversee everything from the qualifiers that determine their starting position on the grid to the race itself. They set the strategy and make sure that this is communicated and executed by their crew, taking into account the external factors such as the track and conditions on race day. When there is an issue that affects operations, it is the principal who empowers the team, which will work to find the solution and chart a course out of any difficulties. Being the team principal in Formula One is also an outward-facing role. Team principals will field many of the media's questions. They will take the criticism when the team doesn't perform as hoped, and they will also take the praise, although the best team principals make sure this is equally shared with the rest of the crew. In addition to leading the way on race day, the principal is also the person who liaises with sponsors, hospitality, marketing, and many more. The principal joins all the dots to make sure that the race crew can do its job to the best of its ability and present the team in the most positive light to the rest of the world. There are clear parallels between being a principal and being a leader in any business. Within business, the principal is not just one person. A business can have multiple leaders at different levels in an organization. In our context, the principal is any leader who defines direction or strategy. In the coming chapters, we are going to explore three key concepts that allow the leaders in any organization to set the direction that the business will move in. In Chapter 1, we look at the importance of selling the dream and vision, of clearly defining the purpose, and the importance of embedding that into the business's DNA from the start. Chapter 2 is all about measurement, because creating the right measures is essential for driving the right behaviors and communicating the purpose that you're trying to achieve. You get what you measure, so you have to make sure that you're putting your focus in the right place. The final chapter in Part 1 is about prioritizing your actions and making sure that you do the important things first. Don't try to boil the ocean. All of these elements are leaders' responsibility. But we also want to be clear that when we talk about a leader, this doesn't have to just mean the leader of a company. It can be anyone who leads teams, leads on strategies, or provides thought leadership. Understanding the concepts we're exploring in Part 1 is important for leaders on every level within an organization. Leaders set the targets, but many businesses shoot for short-term targets because it's generally what shareholders want to see. However, this needs to be balanced with strategic focus on the bigger picture for longevity. This is all part of your culture. If you set short-term targets, people will have a short-term mindset. If you are only looking one step ahead of you as you walk, it's highly likely that you will walk towards a wall. Focusing on the long-term goal without breaking the journey into clear milestones to get there is also far from ideal. If you are only focusing on the horizon, it's highly likely that you will fall down a hole. The key here is balance. Short-term targets are important to gain momentum and start to see progress. However, as we discussed in Chapter 1, you need to be able to keep one eye on this bigger picture to ensure your business and its programs continuously evolve and adapt. Chapter 1. The Peppered Moth. Why Adaption and Evolution Are Essential in 21st Century Business. Being a fish out of water is tough, but that's how you evolve. Kumail Nanjiani. We like to begin by transporting you back to 19th century England. The Industrial Revolution is taking hold, and the factories in the country's industrial heartlands are burning coal and pumping out black smoke. The residue from this smoke coats everything from buildings to trees. Enter the peppered moth. In the 1800s, naturalists observed that peppered moths have evolved to fit in with this changed environment. The peppered moth is often found on the trunk of the silver birch tree, and therefore its natural coloration is pale with darker spots, to match the color of the tree's bark and camouflage it from predators. In highly industrialized areas of England, however, these moths were becoming darker in color. The pale-colored moths stood out too much on the now blackened bark of the trees and were therefore much easier for predators to spot. As a result, the pale moths were being eaten, leaving the darker-colored moths to survive and breed. Meanwhile, in regions where there was considerably less industrialization, the peppered moths remained pale in color. They had no need to change their camouflage because their trees were not being darkened by soot. This is probably one of the best documented stories of adapt or die. Peppered moths in industrialized areas adapted and evolved because those that didn't, died. It's really that simple. To this day, it's still widely considered to be one of the best examples of Darwinian evolutionary theory. What does your business have in common with the humble peppered moth? It too has to adapt, or it will die. In the business world, just as in nature, our environment is continuously changing, and that means we can never stop adapting to match it. There are many organizations in the world today that are undergoing a period of transformation because they have fallen behind and they need to catch up. What we're talking about here is not only transforming to catch up, but making adaptation and evolution a core part of your business so that you never fall behind again, or ideally, that you never fall behind in the first place. As a leader, it is your responsibility to determine the vision, paint that picture, and state your organization's purpose so that you never fall behind again. Think about the Formula One race team principal who is continuously evolving the team's strategy and car to make sure the team stays ahead of the pack. The principal's driver knows exactly what has to be done on the track. The crew knows exactly what's expected of it before, during, and after the race.
This clear direction is what allows all on that team to function to their best ability. However, a Formula One season is never just one race. Depending on performance throughout the season, not only will there be pivots and changes to the strategy set by the principal, but the end destination might also change. A string of poor results might suddenly see your driver and team aiming for third in the championship rather than first, or a series of exceptional wins could put your team on course for winning the championship, where your initial goal at the start of the season was a top 5 finish. The evolution mindset. 3M is an American company that you might be familiar with, and it perfectly encapsulates the evolution mindset that we're exploring in this chapter. In the 1970s, 3M used to be called Minnesota Mining and Manufacturing, and at this time its scientists received a patent for the chemical formula that it was using to make masking tape, which had been in production since the 1950s. The story goes that the board was torn between whether to become a product company or a knowledge and know-how company. If the board had chosen to become a product company, the company's product would have been masking tape. Of course, the company would have made different types, colors, and sizes of masking tape, but it would have pinned itself into a specific niche. The board chose to go down the route of becoming a knowledge and know-how company, and 3M has since spawned over 60,000 products from that one chemical formula. The core of 3M is that formula, and it has used that to continuously evolve and create new things. Whether the board members recognized it at the time or not, they chose to go down a route of continuously adapting. They chose a process of continuous evolution. This is supported by the fact that 3M puts a material percentage of its turnover back into R&D, and it encourages its employees to come up with new products and solutions. It empowers its people based on this core principle of adapting and evolving. It's an evolution mindset that starts at the top and filters all the way through the organization. The Bandersnatch process. In business, we have to pivot and change direction sometimes, and it's important to remember that the destination we're striving for could also change depending on the route we follow. We also have to recognize that we are never going to reach that destination because that implies an end point. In business, there is no end, merely a constant evolution and adaptation to stay ahead of the competition. Just look at 3M. The interactive film Bandersnatch, which was produced as part of the Black Mirror series for Netflix, is a simplified example of this process at work. As the viewer, you choose the direction the storyline took at various points throughout the film. In taking certain decisions around the plot, you influence the ending that you saw. Unlike the world of business, Bandersnatch does of course have an end. However, it illustrates the point about choosing your direction of travel well. Much like in real life, in Bandersnatch, you don't know what ending you're heading towards when you start watching the film. Each decision you take for the main character leads you along a specific story arc. You're essentially opening a door and stepping through it without knowing what's on the other side, even if you might be able to predict what you expect to see. Another key difference between Bandersnatch and business is that in Bandersnatch, you can never go back. Once you take a decision about your direction of travel, you are committed to that trajectory. In business, this might be true in some cases, but not in others. Often it will be possible to step back through a metaphorical door. What we have to recognize in a business context is which doors we can leave open to step back through if we need to, and which ones close behind us, leaving us to navigate forward from that point. As a business, it's vital to make that distinction, because if you're stepping through a door that will close behind you, you need to be confident of your next steps from there. How can you tell if the door you're about to step through will stay ajar or close behind you? There are a few factors that will play a role here. The first is the speed at which you're traveling through that door, because if you race through really quickly, by the time you realize you want to go back, you might be too far from the door. The second is measurement, which we will discuss in greater detail in Chapter 2. But fundamentally, if you're measuring the right things, you will be in a position to retrospectively change the elements that need changing. Each business will be different, and therefore whether it's able to go back through a door will vary. However, all leaders should be challenging themselves on these decisions. As a leader, what you have to work out is whether getting a particular decision wrong is reversible. If the answer to that question is no, you have to take time to make that decision. if the decision won't kill your business, you have to consider what the cost will be for you to step back through that door and course correct. The deciding factor should be whether the opportunity outweighs the risk of making the decision quickly. Don't proxy process for performance. Picture the scene. You're in a meeting with a client pitching them an innovative solution that you've invented. It's going to cost your client £1 million per year to buy this solution, and they have estimated the opportunity cost for them will be £25 million. You know your solution is ahead of the market, and because it's not available through any other providers, you're confident as you walk through your pitch. It's a slam dunk. Or is it? There are many examples in business where process gets in the way of logic. Logically, you would think that spending £1 million a year to gain £24 million is a no-brainer for a business of any size. However, here is an example of where this is played out in a global organization. A client firm was offered a solution to a specific business problem that was not available from any other provider at that time. However, the client firm was concerned that because the solution wasn't available with any other providers, the firm might not be getting a fair deal. As part of its procurement process, the firm mandated the company pitching to go to the tender for the project. Can you see where this is going? Essentially, this meant that the supplier had to facilitate competitors to pitch on its idea. Following the tender process, the client firm was concerned that the supplier might be £200,000 more expensive than the other options. Remember that the opportunity cost to the client was £25 million per year and that the supplier had the solution ready to go. The client took 2 years to make a decision, at which point it chose the initial supplier, which was the organization that pitched the idea in the first place. The client lost £50 million in opportunity cost to make sure it wasn't spending £200,000 a year more than it should. Its process completely dominated logic. There is a good chance that if the client had paid the £1 million, it could have saved 2 years of time and taken a chunk of that £50 million in opportunity cost. This story highlights the danger of allowing your process to dominate logic. We can all think of scenarios in which a business decision has been driven by process rather than by the opportunity that the decision carries. As businesses grow, they become more process-driven and they start to put each decision through the same process, whether it's for a £100,000 project or a £20 million project. Sometimes you just have to let the logical solution take over and leave the processes behind. If a Formula One driver spots a gap in the race to jump up a few places to a pole position, the principal can't let that opportunity slip just because it's not on the race plan, but instead adapts the plan. Emotional intelligence is more than a process. There is a lot of talk within businesses across all sectors about the need to have empathy. However, we believe that focusing only on empathy isn't enough. What businesses need instead is to focus on emotional intelligence. What's the difference? Empathy often feels like a box that needs to be ticked. Are you empathetic with customers? Yes, good, job done. In some companies, you can almost hear them saying, if you want empathy, go down the corridor and it's the third door on your left. This misses the point. Emotional intelligence, EQ, on the other hand, is much more about empowerment. Empathy is a part of that. But when you focus on emotional intelligence within your organization, what you're doing is empowering people to think differently and giving them the authority to make decisions that are in the best interests of your customers and therefore your business. Rich's take. Would you like a free coffee? Pret a Manger is a great example of a company that allows and encourages its staff to use EQ when dealing with customers. It gives its customer-facing staff the authority to give away a certain amount of free product each week, but it doesn't specify who should receive that free product. It's at staff's members' discretion who they give those freebies to. I benefited from this policy when I used to buy a coffee from a Pret store near my office every morning. One of the baristas who worked there got to know me, and some days she'd spot me at the back of the queue and nudge me to the front, hand me a free latte, and I'd be on my way. Now, I'm sure that in many instances, the barista had mistakenly made a latte when someone ordered a cappuccino, so she had a spare latte and would give it to me. But she had the power to use that mistake to delight a regular customer. Principles guide the business. The reason that having solid principles is so important is that you can't possibly map every single customer journey or interaction, or predict every single reason that a customer might get in touch with your business. What you can do is embed a set of principles so deeply into your company that everybody knows how to respond in any situation in a way that matches your brand. Rich's take. Can you help us improve, please? I've been a customer with Harry's, which provides a razor blade subscription service, for some time. And at Christmas, the company emailed me about a special edition razor it was offering. It wasn't expensive at £24, and for an extra £10, I had the option of having it engraved. I thought an engraved razor would make a nice gift for my son, so I ordered one. When it arrived, my first thought was that my order was wrong, because all I could see was Harry's written on the top of the razor. Then I realized that my son's initials were engraved on the bottom of the handle, and the engraving was so faint I could barely read it. It's fair to say I was disappointed, so I sent Harry's an email, explaining my issues with what I received. This was at 8 p.m. on a Thursday night. Very quickly, I received a reply from a lady who told me her name was Sunny. She apologized and told me that the money was already on its way back to my account. She also asked if I could take a photo of the engraving and send it to the company so that it could improve its engraving process. Shortly after this exchange, I received another email asking me to rate Sunny out of 5. I rated her 5 out of 5. I then received another email that said, "Thanks for rating Sunny 5 out of 5. What would you do for Sunny? Buy her a beer, give her a day off, or send her on a vacation?" All of this happened at 8 p.m. on a Thursday night for a £34 product. Her response to my complaint was driven by the principles in that business, because there is no way that she would have a specific process to deal with a complaint about a faint engraving on one of the company's razors. Compare and contrast that example about Harry's razors with another experience Rich had with a very different brand at a similar time. He wanted to test drive an £80,000 car from a luxury brand in preparation for an automotive presentation, so he contacted two dealers on a Sunday night to book his test drive. One dealer got in touch with him by lunchtime on Tuesday, and he was still waiting to hear from the other dealer he contacted. That's a stark difference. Harry solved a problem with a £34 product within minutes at 8 p.m. on a Thursday night, but a luxury brand, at best, took 1.5 days to respond to a request for a test drive and, at worst, didn't respond at all. As a leader, selling the vision you have for your company goes hand in hand with embedding those core principles in the business. To get buy-in from not only everyone who works for you, but also your customers, you need to very clearly paint this vision from the outset. Without having clarity over this vision, you will also struggle to set the direction for the business. The best way I found to open that aperture without losing the focus is to bring together a data-informed narrative that includes signals on brand relevance and saliency, customer engagement, where consumer trends are going, along with quantitative marketing attribution. Imperfect as it may be, marketers are fundamentally storytellers, and it is incumbent upon us to shape a more nuanced story of what drives short and longer-term brand success. Then, it's all about having a CEO and board who can take that in and believe in it too. Marissa Thalberg, EVP, Chief Brand and Marketing Officer, Lowe's. Look at the 3M example that we shared earlier in this chapter. Board members clearly set the vision for the company when they decided to focus on knowledge rather than products. This key principle translates into cultural behaviors within the business that filter through to every person who works for and with you. In starting here, you're ingraining this behavior and empowering your employees to start building a culture that reflects what you're trying to achieve. It's like a waterfall effect, and it all starts from effective communication from leadership. The aim is an adaptive organization that can transform motion into progress. As a business, you might be working towards transforming your customer experience, but what we want to help you achieve is becoming an adaptive organization. Why is that distinction important? Because there is no end. As we said earlier, this isn't a linear process with a final destination. It's a constant evolution. The peppered moth that we talked about at the beginning of this chapter embodies that concept. Not only did the moths living in highly industrialized areas become darker in color as their environment became polluted by the soot from factories, those same populations of moths has since returned to a lighter color because a lot of the pollution that existed decades ago has been cleaned up. That species has continued to evolve to adapt to its current environment. A business is no different. As a leader, you need to have a transformative mindset, which means that you're able to reframe your dream or vision for the business when required.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.